India is one nation. It is one people. It has to be ruled as one country. The significant, profound message of the decision 4 days ago by Prime Minister Modi and Shri Amit Shah and the Indian Parliament was that we are rejecting the three-nation theory of 40s and 50s vintage. Because I'm on record, I won't talk anything further about the other theory. I leave it to your imagination. Because friends, I don't have to today probably explain to you about the evils of this 370 article, how bad it has been, how bad it was, how it affected the lives of millions and millions of people of Jammu and Kashmir, because in the last 4 or 5 days, that is all that has been talked about in the media and elsewhere. So you probably know a lot of it. But let me start by saying, especially by responding to some of those critics, that how can you do away with it without talking to people? Two things I want to say. We have been talking and talking and talking to people for 70 years. We have been telling the countrymen that this is a bad law. This is not good for India, not good for its integration, its unity. The victims of it, they are in front of you. The victims are not just Kashmiri Pandits, not just people of Jammu, not just people of Ladakh. There are refugees from West Pakistan, there are refugees from Pakistan, Jammu and Kashmir. There are thousands and thousands of people in Kashmir Valley who have been the victims of this law. We have been telling them. Just 3 or 4 days before the actual thing unfolded in the parliament, I was in Srinagar. We addressed a few rallies. There was a very lot of tension in the air at that time because there was this inkling that something was going to happen. We told people that whatever happens will be for the good of you, good of the people of Jammu and Kashmir, including people of the valley. We have been talking to the people all the while. But may I ask, when this most illegitimate law was brought in, who was consulted? Friends, I tell you the history of this law. Probably those of you who do not know how it took birth would realize that it was the most undemocratic law in our constitution. It was contemplated in the draft constitution as 306A. When the draft of this law, which exactly became 370 subsequently when final constitution was finally drafted and presented, 306A was drafted by Gopala Swami Iyengar. He was chosen by Jawaharlal Nehru to do that job. He was asked to handle the matter of Jammu Kashmir's accession to India. We all know that the accession of 535 other states, other principalities in the country was handled single-handedly by Sardar Patel. But this one state, Jammu and Kashmir, its accession, the process of completing the accession was handed over to Mr. Gopala Swami Iyengar, because Gopala Swami Iyengar, according to Nehru, was familiar with the situation in the state because he had been the Prime Minister under Maharaja Hari Singh for 6 years. Fair enough. In fact, Sardar Patel protests. Sardar Patel says, why should you do that? I am the Home Minister. It's like Article 370 abrogation being passed not by Home Minister but by some parliamentarian. So Patel protests. When Patel protests, Nehru writes him a very angry letter. Let Home Ministry not overstep. This falls in the domain of Prime Minister to decide who handles what. So don't humiliate a person like Gopalaswamy Iyengar. You know, the matter reaches a level where the Patel decides to resign as Home Minister. All this on one issue of Kashmir, remember. Then Gandhi is still alive, Gandhi intervenes and pacifies Patel and says, let Nehru handle this one state. Remember this, because aage jaakar main bataunga kaise jhoot bola jata hai. Lying is not new in Congress party. When this Article 306A was presented first to Congress Working Committee for its approval, do you know that entire Congress Working Committee stood up like one man and said, no, we don't accept this discrimination. Those leaders who are sitting in the parliament and campaigning that it is we who brought this law for this good of the people, this, that, should know the history of their own party. Only two people, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad and Gopalaswamy Iyengar himself, only two of them were in favor. The entire Congress Working Committee was opposed to this law. The result was, on day one of the Working Committee meeting, this proposal was rejected. Nehru was in America. Nehru telephones Sardar Patel. Then Nehru says, you see, it's a commitment I already gave to Sheikh Abdullah. I can't go back on this now. You have to do something. It's your responsibility to go and convince the CWC, and somehow you have to pass it. Now, Patel was in a dilemma. He never wanted this kind of special treatment to one state. Because remember, article, instrument of accession, the document under which 540 plus different principalities have joined Indian dominion. That was dominion at that time, not union at that time. It was dominion. Indian dominion. It was the same document for all the different principalities. There are no different documents for different states. Same document. Patel was in a dilemma. We have treated 535 of them one way, and the one kingdom of J&K needs to be tackled differently. How do I respond to others? What reply do I give to other kings? But then he had this dilemma. If I today say that no, I don't do that, Nehru will go to town and tell people that, you see, Patel never supported me. He did not want that kind of bickering right at the dawn of India's independence. So he took it upon himself. He brings back that resolution which was rejected on day one, before the CWC on day two, and convinces the members that, see, this is a commitment Nehru already gave to Sheikh Abdullah. Let us not humiliate our leader. Now, I may ask, did it come through a democratic process? It came because one leader's fanciful commitments had to be honored. Now, when it was to be presented before the Constituent Assembly, there the decision was to be taken, there the discussion was to happen. The rule for all the different 534 states was that the representatives in the Constituent Assembly from those different states, which were recognized as the entities in the Constituent Assembly list, will be that each of these principalities will nominate four members. Two will be nominated by the ruler. Two will be nominated by the last existing assembly of that state. If it is Hyderabad state, two members from Hyderabad legislature will be nominated, and two by the Nawab. Similarly from Mysore, similarly from Baroda, similarly from other states. But when it came to the question of Jammu and Kashmir, Nehru said, no, we can't follow that. Because this Jammu Kashmir King Maharaja is a very undemocratic fellow. He should not have any power to nominate anybody. There used to be Jammu Kashmir legislature called Praja Sabha, Jammu Praja Sabha. It was there. Its last election was held in 1946. Constituent Assembly came into being in 1947. So that Sabha was there, which was to be abolished after the accession into Indian dominion by Jammu and Kashmir. But two members from that Sabha were to be nominated by the law. But Nehru said, no, those who got elected in that Sabha, they're all, that election itself is illegal. Why? Because in 1946, when the Praja Sabha election was taking place, Sheikh Abdullah's party, the National Conference, had boycotted that election. Why did they boycott? Because India, you remember, we were in the Quit India movement in 1942. It went on for 3-4 years until 1945. Quit India. Sheikh Abdullah had launched a movement against the ruler, Maharaja Hari Singh, called Quit Kashmir movement. So they wanted Maharaja to leave Kashmir to them and leave, go away. It's called Quit Kashmir movement. Because they had launched this Quit Kashmir movement, Sheikh Abdullah declared that we won't participate in the election. He had not participated in the election. So Nehru's logic was, since Sheikh Abdullah did not participate in Praja Sabha election, the Praja Sabha should not be recognized. You know what was the final decision? Nehru had his way to decide that Maharaja Hari Singh would nominate 4 people, but as per the advice of Sheikh Abdullah. And the 4 members from Jammu and Kashmir in the Constituent Assembly in India, of India, were Sheikh Abdullah himself. He nominated himself as one of the members. And he nominated another 3 members of National Conference. Those who were propagating three-nation theory at that time had been made the official voice of Jammu and Kashmir in the Constituent Assembly. They were the only people supporting this 306A. Is this the way the democracies function? Is this the way of eliciting public opinion before promulgating an act? No, it entered in such a very wrong way. It had a dark history. Now we claim that this is such a solemn commitment to people of Jammu and Kashmir. Which commitment is it? It creates a country within the country. It created a country within the country. You had 2 prime ministers. You had 2 national flags. You know, when we formed the government together with the PDP in Jammu and Kashmir, the biggest embarrassment for our ministers was only one thing. They were all provided official cars as ministers. They all had a red bulb, that is fair. But they used to have 2 flags. One Jammu Kashmir flag, one Indian flag. Our ministers used to come to me and say, sir, what do we do? There are 2 flags. It's against our conscience. We can't have them. But the rule says we should have them. Because 370. So we found a way that national flag will be free, unfurling. I mean, it's flying. This will be there, but covered. We have to find a way. You know, you had 2 flags. This I'm talking 2 years ago. I'm not talking about 1940s and 1950s. So you can imagine the unholiness of this whole exercise, whole act. That's why when it was put to discussion in the Constituent Assembly, it became a fait accompli for Patel because he was forced into getting CW's approval for it. But even Muslim members like Hasrat Mohani, they stood up and said, why this discrimination? If you are giving this to Jammu and Kashmir, why not to Baroda? Why not to Mysore? Then Gopalaswamy Iyengar gave an elaborate logic. No, special circumstances, we have a responsibility, war situation. Then all of them said, this is our temporary. Then Ambedkar said, all right, if Nehru wanted it to be a special concession to Jammu and Kashmir under special circumstances, let it be temporary. So finally, when it was included in the constitution, it came in as a temporary provision. There is a section called temporary and transient provisions. But that is not even very bigly relevant here, majorly relevant here. But the point remains, it was introduced because some people thought that there are special circumstances. Now, the logic you see, when we decided to convert the residual Jammu and Kashmir, leaving aside the Ladakh part, into a union territory, they pounced on us. It's a great injustice to Jammu and Kashmir. You have erased Jammu and Kashmir state from the political map of India. You have converted it into union territory. We said, Baba, we followed you. When you introduced 370, you said special circumstances. We are doing UT, special circumstances. Now, how can you question us? If there were special circumstances in 1950 for having a 370, there are special circumstances today to have Jammu and Kashmir as a UT temporarily for some time. It is necessary. Friends, let me tell you something. Indian Parliament throughout had never fully accepted the proposition that 370 should remain. Never. And those who tell us today that how can you abrogate it, this route, you know, it's very undemocratic, unconstitutional, the way we have done away with this law. You know, you all know that. We use the route of presidential order. Because Article 370, Clause 3 itself stipulates that any changes or even its abrogation can be done by president through a presidential proclamation, presidential order. The Act itself says, because probably at the time after thorough discussion, probably Ambedkar and others have wisely felt that we have to write its ritual also in this, how to end it. We have to build into it. It was built into it. Now when we use the truth, when President has issued an order stating that all the clauses in this Article 370 stand nullified, our opposition says it's undemocratic, unconstitutional. May I ask a simple question? 1950 to 2019, Article 370 has been modified more than 45 times. The first modification happened right under the nose of Jawaharlal Nehru in 1952, when Maharaja post was abolished. In that place came Sadar Riyasat. It was 1952. You know, it followed the same route. It happened simply through a presidential proclamation. And the notorious 35A. In 1954, it was introduced into our constitution using clause 3 of Article 370, again through presidential order. Since then, till date, it was amended more than 45 times, every time through the same route. If you do it, it is genuine. If we do it, it's unconstitutional. In our case, we have placed it before the parliament. We sought the approval of the parliament. We secured it and we got the bill passed. Whereas on many of these cases, in many of these cases in the past, no parliament approval was ever sought. In fact, that is the strongest argument against Article 35A today in the Supreme Court, whenever Supreme Court takes it up again. If at all they take it up. Because after all, it's a legal matter. how, which way Supreme Court goes, we don't know. And there were constant objections to it, constant. We all know about Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. He gave a very big speech in 1952 when the question of, when this amendment happened. Sadre Riyasa Singh came in, he raised objections. Sadre Riyasa is equal to Prime Minister. How can you have two Prime Ministers in one country? How can you have two constitutions in the same country? How can you have two flags in the same country? So he gave a long speech and then he went on a protest march to Kashmir, never to return. That history I think most of you know. But continuously there were opposition, there were protests, there were objections to continuance of this law. So much so that, you know, Mr. Azad and others should read the history of the Congress party themselves. In 1963, when a delegation from Jammu and Kashmir goes to Nehru protesting against this draconian law, Nehru gave that famous reply to the delegation. It is recorded subsequently in history. He told them that giste giste gis jayega. So gisa nahi hai, usko pakad ke phekna pada. But Nehru's that time reply was, don't worry, it will erode and corrode by itself, don't worry. When the issue was brought before him in parliament, I mean there was an oral reply to it in the parliament. And in that oral reply, Nehru, on record, admitted that Article 370 was not doing any good to the people. This was Nehru's own admission. He said, no, it's unsatisfactory, it's not really helping. He goes on to say that, Article 370, that way we have diluted it so much. The another member, Congress party member, tells the house that 370 has just remained as a paper tiger today. This was Congress party in 63. Today, look at the language. And so, 370 is the most sacred thing in the entire constitution. Friends, this Article 370 had a constitutional history, that is why I am saying all this. All the while, nobody had wanted it. No, everybody wanted it to go, including Nehru. Today, we have achieved it. We have completed that job. The amount of harm that Article 370 has done to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, I don't need to go on giving you so many details. You all know, because again, as I said, in the last 4 days, whatever happened, one good thing is that our media has helped educate every Indian about Kashmir. Today everybody knows what is 370, what is Kashmir, what is happening there and all that. I can give you one or two latest examples. Why we decided that it should go was, you see, basically we wanted three things to happen there. For all the three things, this one article was becoming a major impediment. Now these three things, if I tell you, you will say, sir, what is this? This has to happen everywhere. What are those three things? One, development. Such a simple thing, development should happen everywhere. Second, political empowerment. Everywhere it should happen. Third is dignity. Dignity should be there everywhere. But do you know, even these things, which you will say, sir, these are common things, what is that they should happen? Even they could not be achieved in the state of Jammu and Kashmir because this villain called 370 had existed. We gave recently, we wanted to give political empowerment to the state. There only the families, Mufti family, Abdullah family. If you go, I come. If I go, you come. It has become a fiefdom. In fact, our MP from Ladakh, Mr. Jamyang, he spoke so well. He said in Hindi, "Aapne, he told his people that aapne shasan nahi kiya, aapne raj kiya." You remember these words? Which are absolutely undoubted. It has become the fiefdom of these two families. So So we, when we decided that no, we should give power to grassroots, we held panchayat elections. Omar Abdullah Saab said, oh, what is so great about it? I also conducted panchayat election in 2009. Yes, you also conducted it. But that was just a ritual. Because panchayats never had any power. Do you know that under the 73rd, 74th amendment of Rajiv Gandhi's time, when Manishankar Iyer was the panchayat Raj minister, some names are important to recollect here. You may or may not like me taking up those names. But the fact that people should know that people who brought in those amendments to panchayat Raj system and empowered the panchayats administratively and financially. That was the 73rd, 74th amendment. You give funds directly to panchayats. Center will give funds directly to panchayats. But that could not be implemented in Jammu and Kashmir because that was never approved by Jammu and Kashmir constitution. 370 was used to deny the rights of common Kashmiri people. When I say Kashmiri people, people of Jammu and Ladakh also, in the broader sense. So we decided, when we decided, we gave a committee. In fact, the state administration, which was under governor's rule, issued a one full page advertisement in all the Kashmiri papers. The advertisement was, come participate in these elections. After the elections, once the village panchayats will be formed, we will give each village panchayat 25 lakh rupees per annum. No, that is why the great two families decided to boycott panchayat election. When they boycotted, they thought that election wouldn't be held. But people in thousands came forward. And today, a vibrant panchayat Raj system is there in Jammu and Kashmir, including Kashmir Valley. 4,000 sarpanches are there in Kashmir Valley. They defied the diktats of these big leaders. They said, we want empowerment. But what was coming in the way was this 370. Even we could not have given, we could not have been able to give the 25 lakhs because the law doesn't permit. You only can give to state government under general head. And we have been giving state government in all these years very charitably. Do you know between 2000 and 2016, Jammu and Kashmir state got 1,10,000 crores as central aid. 10% of the entire central assistance to states used to go to Jammu Kashmir. 10%. And Jammu Kashmir's population, by the way, is just 1% of the country's population. Country's population is 130 crores, Jammu Kashmir population is 1.3 crores. 1%. 1% population, 10% central assistance, but would never reach the people. Highest poverty, highest backwardness, highest illiteracy. So we could not really empower them as long as 370 existed. We decided it should go so that I can empower people. Political empowerment can happen. You know those who are opposing it precisely for that reason. Today, their bread and butter is at stake. New leaders are emerging in villages. Today, BJP has 6 municipal chairmen in Kashmir Valley. Doesn't matter, we have all the municipalities in our, all the major municipalities in our hands in Jammu. It's a known story. But what is unknown to people is, 6 municipalities in Kashmir Valley are today controlled by BJP. We have 200 sarpanches, BJP sarpanches in the valley. Thousands in Jammu, but 200 in the valley.
6 chairmen out of?
About 40-45 municipalities there. So, what I'm trying to say is we have empowered people politically. The second issue came up about development. Do you know that the last major private industry to go into Jammu and Kashmir was in 1950s? When I said it, somebody telephoned to me and said, one of my friends said, no, you are wrong. In 1972, even when the secretary opposed Mr. Mr. N.D. Tiwari at that time, I think he was the minister for minister for heavy industry or something. He had taken HMT to Srinagar. I told him two things. Number one, remember, secretary opposed it. Because he knew you cannot run it there. Number two, in 10 years, that industry had collapsed. Even public sector could not run there. No private sector went. Why? Because you cannot own land. You cannot have, you have a private sector industry there, you have a general manager who is an IITian from Bengaluru. He goes with his family. His children cannot get any admission in any government school. He cannot get ration card because he is not the state subject. There is a special category called state subjects. Only they are authorized to enjoy all the benefits of the state. And remember, Jammu Kashmir is one state which runs 70% of its revenues are managed by central money. But then you and I cannot have anything. It's such a discriminatory thing. A Kashmiri can come to Srinagar or anywhere, a Jammu person, anybody can come to anywhere in the country. He will become anybody like you and me, a normal citizen like you and me. But you and I go, you won't have that right. So development would not go there. There are no good hospitals today in Jammu and Kashmir except government hospitals. No Apollo. They won't go. With great difficulty, two big hotels went, one Taj and one Lalit. And the door, both of them come and tell us, sir, we are very worried because we only have lease agreement. We don't have the ownership of the land. Anytime the fellow can say that, get out, I have to go. Will industry go? So development has suffered. And the third important point is, as I said, the dignity of the people. There are people, Prime Minister has spoken about it day for yesterday on TV. He said very rightly, there are people who have been living in that state for 70 years now. They still cannot enjoy any benefits of the government because they are treated as non-state subjects. Amit Shahji has spoken about it. I hope you all remember. Amit Shahji gave a very interesting comparison. That Dr. Manmohan Singh was a refugee from Punjab in Pakistan. He came to India. He rose to become the Prime Minister of India. Same was the case with Indra Kumar Gujarat. I would say same was the case even with Advani Ji. Although he did not come as a refugee, he came a little early. But he also came from Pakistan. Same Sindh area. He became, he rose to become Prime Minister of India. But we have close to, Deputy Prime Minister of India, we have close to 1 lakh families in Jammu region mainly, along the Jammu Pakistan, along the Pakistan border, who today cannot even get a ration card. Why BSP supported us, do you know? These 1 lakh families, 90% are scheduled castes. They came into India at the time of partition. They were coming into Punjab. Sheikh Abdullah stopped them in Kashmir and told them, no, you remain here so that I can tell the world that I have repudiated two nation theory. He did not say that I am propagating my own three nation theory. But you will be my showpiece for telling the world that I had rejected two nation theory, so you stay back. Poor people, believing in Sheikh Abdullah, they stayed back. From then till date, they did not have basic citizen rights in that state. It's so funny, I'm not even funny, so shocking that they come and vote in parliament election, they have no right to vote in assembly election. If suppose the elections are held together, they are only authorized to vote for the MP, they are not authorized to vote for MLA, because they are not state subjects, their children cannot get into any government school, if they fell sick, they cannot go to government hospital, because they are not having state subject card. This is what I mean by dignity. And you know the lives of pandits for last, how many years now, almost 30 years. Wretched lives they are leading. You cannot do anything because this great 370 will come in the way of doing anything there. the question of human dignity was also paramount when this Derby decided they should go. Friends, finally, it has gone. But I must tell you, removing it is the first step towards what the three objectives I mentioned, achieving those three objectives, development, dignity, and empowerment. We need to now go a long way in achieving these things. Our government is very committed. We will do all that is possible to ensuring that the fruits of development reach the people of Jammu and Kashmir. You know, any amount of explanation may not convince some people in the valley, I admit. Because they were fed a lot of emotional wrong information for decades on. But good development will speak for itself. We will take the fruits of development to the last man in the state. We have divided, we have given union territory status to Ladakh. It has been a long pending demand of people of Ladakh. We have accomplished, we have fulfilled their demand. Now Ladakh will prosper. Ladakh will develop fast. The remaining state of Jammu and Kashmir, the challenges that it faces, whether in terms of the future of Kashmiri Pandits. You know, Kashmiri Pandits, for their right to go back into their homes and huts in Kashmir Valley, it depends on two things. Number one, security. We should be in a position to provide security to them. But security is a physical establishment. We have, when our government came, we have announced 7,000 jobs for Kashmiri Pandits. 3,500 Kashmiri Pandits have taken those jobs. They tried to go back and settle. We had to create secure areas for them to live. Mostly areas where police and military, paramilitary establishment is there, there they were made to live. But security is not enough. You need also to give them dignity of life. You cannot make them prisoners in Kashmir Valley. At least they are free birds in Bengaluru, free birds in Jammu, free birds in Delhi. You take them to Kashmir Valley and give them security, keep them in a prison. That is not what we want. We need to create that situation where security is of course there, but dignity is also ensured. We shall do that. We have plans. We had tried some discussions with Kashmir groups and Mufti was the chief minister. It's another matter, we could not continue it when Mehboob became the chief minister. We tried for a year, it did not work, so we dumped the government. But we tried it when Mufti was the chief minister. We identified 5 locations. We thought that in each place we will have 20,000 Pandit families at one place, so that it will become a big township. There was a debate within the Pandit community that some, whether it should be exclusive colonies or mixed colonies, it can be debated and decided. That's not a big deal. But that will be taken forward. So those things we will complete. Similarly, now that 370 is gone, all the discriminatory laws have gone. There is no need to announce it further now. It's gone. The 370 abrogation bill or the bifurcation bill states that as many as 150 state laws stand repealed. With one stroke, we have repealed all those discriminatory laws. In one stroke, 120 central laws get extended to that state. You know, in the 80s, in 70s and 80s, what happened was, Jammu Kashmir needed safai karmacharis, scavengers. Because manual scavenging was in practice there. They took so many of them from North India. Subsequently, Modi's government has abolished this manual scavenging, but it was not implemented in Jammu and Kashmir because 370 they used it and did not implement this act of abolishing manual scavenging. Manual scavenging was in force until 4 days ago in Jammu and Kashmir. It's a humiliation to people. That's why BSP supported us, because it stands eliminated now. No more humiliating job of manual scavenging. It's done away with. All that we will do, development will reach, political empowerment will happen. As I said, we have extended UT status for certain security related reasons and all. And also, we need to do some revamp of Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu and Kashmir did not have delimitation. Delimitation happened in the entire country before 2009 election. But it did not happen in Jammu and Kashmir. Instead, Jammu and Kashmir Assembly under great Farooq Abdullah as Chief Minister had passed an amendment to their own constitution stating that until 2026, there is no delimitation. They had passed a law for 30 years. Now, all that stands annulled because there is no Jammu and Kashmir constitution anymore. It's gone. So, the delimitation exercise will take place. We have announced in that bill that we will give 114 seats to the residual Jammu and Kashmir state, 114, out of which 24 seats are in Pak-occupied Kashmir, POK. Remaining 90 seats will become the legislature of Jammu and Kashmir Assembly. Right now there are only 83 seats, it will be 90 after the delimitation exercise is completed. So delimitation has to be undertaken, a commission will be appointed, very soon delimitation will be completed, then the state gets its first full-fledged legislature under the Indian government system, not Jammu and Kashmir system. It will be a full-fledged legislature the state will get. Finally, let me say a few words about our neighbor. बहुत कूदा है, बहुत उछल कूद कर रहा है. 370 abrogation is a sovereign right of Indian Parliament. Nobody has any local standby on it. We have such wise men in Congress Party. Their parliamentary Lok Sabha party leader was stating, Adhir Rajan Chaudhary was stating, no, it's an issue between India and Pakistan. It is an international issue. UN, and UN is saying, no, it's not our issue, it's India's issue. Believing in Adhir Rajan Chaudhary, Imran Khan wrote a letter to UN. UN said, yeah, you don't know Adhir Rajan Chaudhary, in 24 hours he's going to do a U-turn. Which he did. He said, no, it's an internal matter. We have always said that Jammu and Kashmir is ours. It's our own federation. We have modified Article 370 45 times in the past, as I said. Have we consulted Pakistan every time? Why should they jump? Why should they scream? It's our Jammu and Kashmir. Whatever we want to do, we will do. And that's what we have done. And today, Russia told the same thing to Pakistan. UN said the same thing. China said the same thing. Trump said the same thing. Everybody is saying, Baba, keep quiet now. You anyway don't have any respect outside. What do you raise? But then, let me tell you, in 1994, Indian Parliament has passed a unanimous resolution. This is not BJP. It was Congress government at that time. P.P. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister. We passed a unanimous resolution stating only outstanding issue to settle is POK. Pak-occupied Kashmir. That's the only outstanding issue. On that, we will talk to Pakistan. But only with Pakistan. No third country. So let us at least as Indians be clear that one strong message that should go out to all Indians is that we should stop looking at Kashmir from Pakistan prism. Yes. don't look at from Pakistan prism. Just look at from our own prism of Indian constitution, Indian unity, Indian integrity. We can solve all the problems of Kashmir. That's what we are doing. We are sure with the support of the people, of the countrymen, and under the leadership of Prime Minister Modi, we will achieve all the remaining outstanding issues also. Thank you very much.